bringing you all of the local motocross racing from North Carolina, Virginia, and the surrounding states. The Imperative MX Podcast. Here's another episode.
And we're back and ready to rip here on the Imperative MX Podcast, episode number 7. And man, we are glad to be back for yet another week and another episode. And we are bringing you all of the local motocross action from North Carolina, Virginia, and the surrounding states. Thank you so much for joining us yet another week and another episode here on the Imperative MX Podcast. I am your host, Zach Newberry, and we would like to thank each and every person that have been enjoying these first couple of episodes already, and the great positive feedback from these has truly just been humbling. So if you've not checked out any of the past episodes, do yourself a favor and check them out after this one. Pretty much now available everywhere: Apple, Spotify, Amazon Music, YouTube, Pandora, Listen Notes, and many more. So make sure to check out the other episodes if you have not. It is truly awesome just to see the support from the local community in the sport of motocross. I want to thank you, the listeners, for tuning in this week here on the Imperative MX Podcast. And we have a lot to talk about on tonight's episode. So there's a lot of talking points to get into, all the way from local racing to professionals. And man, we have Minio's Amateur National Conversation Part 2, talking about the Motocross Championship. Last episode, we talked about the Supercross Championships down in Newberry, Florida. So we'll cover the Motocross portion of it. And we have a first-time call-in from Kyle Travis, who is Dax Bennick's practice bike mechanic for a really long time up until this point. So it'll be really good to chat about this successful trip all the way up to pretty much where Dax is now. So it'll be really good to hear from Kyle Travis in this episode. Then we will switch the gears to some professional Arenacross talk, where we get to talk to the underdog, Kyle Bitterman. He will be calling in and telling us about his kicker Arenacross season so far, with two rounds down, his bounce back podium ride this weekend, and so much more from Kyle Bitterman coming up later as well. We have local racing talk with upcoming racing schedules, answering your social media questions, and so much more on this episode, and you do not want to miss out. I'm actually personally just super stoked for this one, so I can't wait to get into it. But before we do, make sure to check us out on Imperative MX if you have not done so, on Instagram, Facebook, our popular TikTok channel that I think is just a couple of hundred away from 25,000 followers. And it's honestly unbelievable the pace that we are growing on every single social media. So thank you guys so very much for all of the support. And before we get any further into this pod, we have to say thank you to all of the sponsors that are on board here for the Imperative MX Podcast: West Virginia Motorsports, FXR, Silver Valley MX Park, Hydro Power, and Dirt Industries Custom Graphics. We will get more into each of these awesome companies here in a little bit. And make sure that you support the ones that support the sport, just like these companies that are willing to help out with this local podcast to bring you these episodes weekly. So make sure you guys go and check out each one of those companies. Helping me break down all of the talking points for tonight's podcast, the highly likable, hilarious, knowledgeable, your District 29 2011 C-Class champion, and now a proud father, Heavy D. What's going on?
You know it, living the dream, and another day in paradise, brother.
Absolutely. Another day in paradise talking about motocross is an awesome day, Heavy D. How's the week been going?
Oh, dude, it's been going solid, you know, living and loving life. Absolutely. Chilling with the little one and the old lady, and, you know, just staying in tune with the moto industry.
Absolutely. There was a lot of racing that went on this weekend, from Minio's to Arenacross, and even some professional stuff with Ken Roczen perhaps going to HEP Suzuki. Seems like that is the that's the new wave that's going on. So there's a lot to get into, and Heavy D, the first talking point is we have to get into Minio's part two, the motocross championship edition. And man, there was a lot of competition out there, a lot of entry. You know, there was a lot of entries in each one of these classes, so many last chance qualifiers that they had to go through, or consies that they had to go through. But man, I tell you what, the track seemed to hold up a lot better this year than I think previous years. I don't know if that's just me, but I feel like the track, I feel like they did a lot better with the track for this year's Minios down in Newberry, Florida. Heavy D.
Oh yeah, they changed. I want to say it was different last year, and they changed it again. They're starting to change up the track a bit more than usual, you know, which is pretty interesting.
Yeah, because the couple of years that I actually went, they didn't change the track very much. I think it was pretty much the same all the way throughout. And then once I didn't go to Minios anymore is when they actually started changing it, believe it or not. But it seems like the faces of the jumps were a lot better. I know in previous years they had some problems with that, but right now it seems like they've got it down pat with that, and the track was absolutely phenomenal. So and it held well all the way throughout each days. I know probably the fog and the dew in the morning probably helped out with just a little bit more moisture into the ground, but overall, Heavy D, I think it was a pretty solid week of racing.
Oh, absolutely. You know, it looked like a lot of intense battles and good racing, like you say. I mean, which is good for the sport, you know. So, I mean, all around, it definitely seemed like it was a good weekend, a good week, rather. Heck, I know the owner of it, he definitely had a good week. You see how many people was there? It was an unreal amount of people.
Oh, it was a complete mob scene there, man. They had so many people there, and like we talked about on episode number 6 last week, that, you know, they had to make more parking because there were so many people that are coming in nowadays. So it's good to see that the motocross community is growing.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's crazy, you know. Like, I was talking to somebody the other day, and I was saying, you know, it makes no sense how it's like everything is getting more expensive and more people are going racing, which, I mean, it's still good. I think we may have talked about that, but it's crazy. More people are going racing, but more stuff is expensive, and you think it'd be the complete opposite. So it's crazy. How does the industry get better as stuff gets more expensive? When years ago when it fell off and people like stopped races. So I don't know, it's crazy if you think about it.
Yeah, absolutely. And there, and like you were talking about, there was a lot of competition that was there, obviously, with the entry levels, and there was a lot of eye openers that I think got put onto the map and maybe even the radar moving into 2023. I have a handful, Heavy D, that kind of opened up my eyes. You know, I watch Loretta's, right? I see where some of these kids finish and all of that. And then I watch Minios, and it seems like some of these kids do a lot better at Minios, or maybe it's the non-pressure of this is, you know, Loretta Lynn's, right? And it seems like they come out and fire and do really, really well when maybe they had a poor performance or maybe not up to their standard performance at Loretta's, and they end up doing really, really well at Minios. I have a couple in mind. Heavy D, was there any riders from any classes? You can name a couple if you have a couple, or if you just have one, but any eye openers for you?
Oh, absolutely. Of course. One, I mean, I ain't gonna say it was an eye opener, because I mean, the kid's got an insane amount of talent, and of course, Abster Hall, I'm going to say him.
Yeah,
because dude, he went down there. He, you know, he raced the new Cobra e-bike, and yes, I don't think he rode it until then.
Unbelievable.
And Dude, even in the regular 50 classes, like, the kid, he was killing it. Like, seconds, podiums, like, top fives. Like, man, me personally, I understand, like, for Cobra or KTM or some of them, it may not benefit Cobra for them to give him a full-fledged ride. I mean, it should, because, I mean, that looks good on their part, honestly, in my opinion. Like, you take a kid that doesn't ride at all and goes to school, and he hops on a bike that's never been ridden, that they pulled from anyone riding at Loretta's, and they show it up at Minio's, and he goes out there and he gets second. And matter of fact, I think he even won some heat races on it.
Yeah, so I think he won some heat races, and he was actually leading most of the ones that he got second in. So, good TV time for him, and what a hell of a performance, especially if that is true, which I guarantee it is, that he just hopped on it and it just worked out. Or not worked out, but he just showed that he could, you know, do it, you know?
Oh, absolutely. And man, I know his 50 is, I think he has a year or two left on 50s, but I mean, me personally, like, if you can go and get like Ryder D when he's 4 years old and build a foundation, it seems like they do it with the kids that are farther out of state, farther like out, rather than the you know, the kids around here, you know, on the East Coast.
Right.
But if I was like, I mean, me personally, seeing that, if I was KTM or somebody, I would literally go to them and say, all right, we want you on this, and we're going to start building the foundation with you. Like they did with so many of these other kids from back in the day. Because I mean, to me, it would be a smart idea, because he's fast on a 65 too, and right, he don't even have to race it
right
yet, because he's not like technically in full of age to be in that age group, which I mean, he still does, but he's like the younger of the kids, and he still does more than good on the 65.
Yeah, it's crazy the amount of talent that just gets swiped over, right? Like,
oh,
it's crazy.
100%. And Double D, of course, he went down there in B class and top 10.
Yep.
You know, fresh out of C class, which I thought, man, me personally, I thought that was awesome, because he still could have raced C class at Minio's.
Mm-hmm.
And he could have, he could have racked up on titles. But I think it's smart, and it shows the kick on their part. Like, right, all right, like, it's time to move on. Like, we did this, because he's already got his mind set on Loretta's next year. Like, he said, like, I'm going down here in Minio's, I'm going to go ahead and go to B, get my feelings hurt, and then I'm going to show up next year and, like, put in work.
Yeah, but like we were talking about on the last episode, that sometimes it's good to go ahead and get that jump start, even if, you know, you get smoked. It's good to go ahead and get that head start, and especially for Double D, it's really good actually for him to go ahead and get this start at a big level, right? Like, with deep competition in the B class, like, we all know that is there, right? So, you know, it's really good for him to go ahead and have that fresh start to a new class, and, you know, for him to get a top 10, that just shows that that he could do it in that class. And I think, just, you know, by the middle of next summer, I think he's going to be damn near close to front.
Oh, absolutely. And I agree with that 100%. Like, he's definitely going to be there. So he's definitely one. Another one, I'm not going to lie to you, like, I've seen him, and I've always thought he's fast, and I'm not discrediting him by any means, but I personally, like, Kyle told me, he was like, keep a lookout for him, and that's Noah Stevens, which he's fast, but I feel like it's like, B class is always stacked, dude.
Right.
You know that. It is always stacked.
Mm-hmm.
But for him to go get two titles and podium all on a stock 250F, that's damn eye-opening. Excuse my French.
Yeah, no, but that was super impressive, and I'm super stoked for Noah. That just put him even more on the map with good starts. Man, he's a hell of a good starter.
Oh, that's the ticket.
Absolutely.
That's the ticket right there. He's a good starter. I mean, and he goes and gets it, which when I watched him at Verb Classic, dude, he was ripping. I was like, well damn, like, where did he come from? Which, he was fast. He's always been fast. Like, he's always been up front. But it's just like, I'd never really seen that much aggression out of him. You get what I'm saying?
Right. No, like it seemed like he was trying to prove a point, and you could see it.
Exactly. He was aggressive, and like, you know, I like that. Man, I love, like, see a kid attack a track but be flawless doing it.
Right.
So that right there, and if he don't get a ride, somebody needs to be throat punched.
Well, especially for a soft-spoken kid that he is, that you wouldn't, you know, like, he's so soft-spoken, and then when he goes out there, you just see all of his emotion, right? Like, I think that's what I love about the sport, because you can tell from a rider when he's like, I gotta go, like, I've got, you know, like, I'm going to win, like, the confidence level, you can see it in their riding and all of that, and Noah Stevens definitely had it, coming away with a title in the Supercross, and then also, I think he got two in outdoors. Regardless of the fact, it was phenomenal.
Oh, 100%.
And especially at the local, you know, as local as these guys are that we're talking about, right? Like, you know, Jed Dry was out there in the 30+, and Ryan Smith was out there in the in the 30+. So, you know, there was a lot of local guys that were out there, and that was what is really cool to see. So we're actually going to go ahead and get ready to get Kyle Travis on the line here to get ready to talk to. And before we actually do that, we are going to talk about West Virginia Motorsports. And if you are looking for your next ride, look no further than my friends over at West Virginia Motorsports. If you are around the surrounding area and looking for a pre-owned motorcycle, dirt bike, ATV, anything engine related, make sure to go to Princeton, West Virginia, or their other location to get something that you need. Parts, bikes, anything that you need, make sure to go and check out the guys over at West Virginia Motorsports, and we're glad to have them on board. And don't forget those oil filters and air filters, Heavy D, and don't catch them on fire. Don't catch them on fire like Heavy D does. So that's pretty good, Heavy D. A couple episodes ago, you telling us about that. But Kyle Travis is on the line. Dax Bennick, practice bike mechanic for many, many years. Kyle, how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great. How are you guys doing?
Good, man. We appreciate you calling in to the Imperative MX podcast, and man, it's going to be good to hear from you and all the knowledge that you have, and especially for the listeners that may not know you. But how many air filters do you think that you've changed in your mechanicking lifetime?
Oh, wow. Wow, that'd be in the thousands. In the thousands, for sure.
Thousands, yeah. it's definitely a lot, and especially for those guys that you deal with, right, with, you know, going through every day, and especially all the dirt and dust and all of that. So appreciate the guys over at West Virginia Motorsports. But how's everything going for you, Kyle? I know that you do some engine work, and you also do some training for some kids and all of that. So how's everything going?
Everything's been going great. Business has been steady. Working with some local guys. Like you said, had a really good minios. You know, with Noah Stevens, Asher Hall, both multiple podiums each. Daxton, obviously, he crushed it, as long as Hayden did too. And then we also had Bo Reed, had a top 10 in the C class, his first national ever. So definitely had a good run at it this year.
That's awesome. Man, you definitely help out a lot of people. And before you actually called in, we were speaking on Noah Stevens, Heavy D.
Oh, yeah. Matter of fact, because, I mean, I even mentioned before that Noah was working with Kyle, but like I was saying about Noah, I honestly, like I was telling Zach, he's always been fast. There's no doubt about that. But, like, watching him at the Verb Classic and him going to Minios, like, leading up to that, watching him, I never, up until, like, now, it was like he had so much more aggression in him. And you could tell, like Zach said, it was like he went out there and he had something to prove. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And it's a funny thing. You know, we had a good talk there, and you know, basically, you know, I, you know, you got to perform for me to be able to sell. And with that being said, he performed. And thing about it is he's got guys in front of him, guys behind him with rides, and here he is standing alone riding a stock 250F in the stock class, in the mod class, and putting it on the box in both, and yet, you know, still doesn't have a ride. And that's something to be said about our industry, and how tough rides are to come by these days.
Absolutely, and that's what myself and Heavy D talk about a majority of the time here on the Imperative MX podcast, is how much talent is in and around this North Carolina area that it just swipes over industry people's heads, it seems like.
Yeah, I would agree. And it takes the full package in the industry's eyes. You know, they're not just, I mean, this is just for everybody out there. They're not just looking at the rider, you know, in the performance. They're looking at, you know, how, you know, you act, how you carry yourself, how your parents act, how they carry themselves. You know, is the bike in, you know, is it clean going to the line? That's the kind of stuff they're kind of looking at, you know. Should it be, in a sense? I mean, I believe that, you know, if the rider performs, you know, but that's just the way the industry is looking at it. And like I said, I mean, not knowing them, they carry themselves 100% all the way. And that's why it's kind of like, you know, mind blowing to me that he doesn't have a ride at the moment. But to those out there that are trying to earn rides, just understand that, you know, it takes the full package these days.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, these kids that are looking for, you know, these rides, it seems like what me and Heavy D talk about is, you know, here on the East Coast, we really only have two big amateur nationals, right? You have Loretta's that you actually have to qualify for, and then you have Minio's. But other than that, there's really no other way unless you travel a long distance. You know, even for the Moto Combine, right? These kids actually have to get an invitation to go to these, and nobody can just, you know, randomly show up on the line. So it is a very hard industry to get into, and Noah is definitely one of those kids that I believe that he deserves a shot because he has proved it within the last year. I mean, Loretta's just alone was a phenomenal ride for him, and then to come out to Minio's and even to top that and come out with a couple of championships is even more phenomenal.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And with that being said, there's also a race that's developing, Lake Sugar Tree. I think they, what did they call it? Heavy D, the,
Moto Vroom Vroom.
Vroom Vroom. Talked with Greg Geisler. His vision for that race is basically, you know, basically stop in and race it before Loretta's type thing.
Right.
But then also the guys that didn't qualify for Loretta's, it's like a national for the guys that did not make it. So then there's opportunity, you know, for you to be, you know, hit a featured event and catch a number one plate possibly, that's not so far away.
Yeah, and that's actually where I went for Imperative to do some media. You know, you had Josh Grant there, you had Zach Osborne, you had Chad Reed, of course, and then you had Liam Olof all the way from California that showed up. Chase Lawton came from Georgia. You had all of these kids that came from different places to make sure that they ride before Loretta's. And like we say many a times here, it's good to get those gate drops even when maybe not even, you know, the toppest competition was there, because to be honest, Moto Vroom Vroom was kind of slim as far as the competition and gate goes, right? But it was the first event, and I understand that. And talking with Harold Martin, who's the owner of Moto Playground, he said that that's what he expected, right? To go ahead and, you know, and it will grow over time. And that's what I told him, that it's honestly phenomenal to go ahead and have one of these races the week end right before Loretta's, and especially for those kids that are traveling all the way across the country that may not get to ride or race very much. So it actually is really good. And it's good that you came up with that, because I did not know that. So that's actually really good, and good for all of the riders and parents that are listening here on the podcast.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Well, like I said, and that's another thing too, that we have lack of around here, and that's like rough racetracks. So, you know, as many, and what I mean rough, you know, like for instance, Minio's, that's a very rough racetrack. And you go to regionals, that's going to be a rough racetrack. And so basically we need to try to bring as many tracks to that caliper to our riders as much as we can locally, to have them prepared to be able to be successful at the next level.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, you've worked a long time with Dax ever since he was a youngin' before he was even really on the map, and you've known Dax for a long time. What is it with Dax, and what do you like working with him so much that you continue to do it?
Dax is like family. He's such a good kid. You know, he's one of the most talented kids I've ever witnessed on a dirt bike, and you know, I just think he's got what it takes to make it in this industry. Him and Hayden both, to be honest with you. You know, and they're both unique. You know, a lot of people shy away from competition. You know, whenever it's the two top guys in the class, you know, both of them could fall in the first turn and both of them win by 20 seconds. You know, and then they line up and practice with each other 2 months before the national every year.
Right.
And that's something to be about friendship and character. And that's something that they've taught me as well. Like, I wasn't too sure about it at first, but, you know, after I got to know the families and I'm like, I'm down with it, you know, and now it's come full circle for both families, and both riders are on the top of the map, at Star Yamaha. They're crushing it. And I expect big things out of both kids, for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. And that was actually one of the questions that I had. What was, you know, since Dax and Hayden have known each other for a very long time and have actually been mutual friends, even outside of the racetrack with each other, for multiple years, being on the same, you know, Orange Brigade team and all of that, and having to race each other every single time, you know, damn near that they have to get out onto the track. What is the vibe around the track? Do they, you know, they're probably laughing and having a good time around the track and at the truck, and especially now that they're, you know, at the same facility down at the goat farm.
Oh yeah, definitely. They have a great time together. They both strive off of beating one another. I've got stories, you know, one day the other one's beating the other, the next one's beating the other. And Dax was telling me a story. I guess he got the upper end of Hayden. I mean, Hayden, you know, got the upper end of him, you know, 3 or 4 days in a row, and then Dax, I think, got the upper end of him. And Jenny Carmichael's out there like, Hayden, are you gonna let Dax get the better of you today, son? And he just after it, you know.
Right.
You know, but they thrive off each other, really. You know, they really do. They're both tremendous kids. I'll tell you a story. To let, you know, maybe enlighten people. I stepped in the rig after the racing was done, and Daxton, I guess he had told a guy that he had promised a jersey to, and anyway, I stepped in there. I'm like, hey, you know, we got a buddy out here. You promised a jersey. He's like, I realize I don't have no jerseys to give away. And then Hayden's over there in his locker. He goes, yeah, we really don't. He goes, I want to give stuff to everybody, but he's like, we don't have stuff to give away. So that just tells you the personality of both young men, that they want to give the world to everybody. They just don't have enough to give away at the moment.
Right. And I think, you know, for me, especially growing up in the sport and going to these pro motocross races and supercross races, you know, you always wanted to get a jersey or have a, you know, some plastic or, you know, something like that. But it seems like over the years, it seems like kids are maybe pushing it a little bit too far and not showing maybe enough respect for the guys when they don't actually have the stuff to give away, because, you know, maybe they only have a couple of sets to even last them until the, you know, the next week or whatever the case may be for sponsorships and stuff like that. Do you feel like it has changed over time in the industry with as far as training partners go? Because I feel like back in the day, obviously, a lot of these guys kind of worked almost alone, but now it feels like a lot of these facilities are, you know, and teams are almost working as a training facility now. to put all of these guys together to ride every single day. Do you feel like that is kind of like the change in pace and what we're going to see in the next couple of years and actually really moving forward?
Well, I mean, yes, until you become the top dog, you know, until you're a Tomac, you know, a Roxon, you know, them guys seem to want to separate themselves, and I get it, because they're the raddest, and they're just elevating everybody else around them. But again, if you're a good teammate, then you'd want to bring everybody up, but it's a business, so I understand why they would not want to. But as far as everybody else, until you're that top dog in the 450 class, you have something to gain from anybody that's around you as far as your team. So I definitely am a firm believer in unique sparring partners is what I call them.
Right.
You need to line up, have gate drops, and battle with that intensity. You need to bring that intensity, you know, a couple times a week, if not, you know, three or four times a week. A lot of times you'll see guys, they go out and they'll practice, you know, 2-3 weeks, you know, even at the local level, you know, they'll practice and then they'll get to that big race and they pump up within a few laps. Well, that's just, you know, intensity. You know, it's not that they're not in shape. It's just that they're riding at a higher intensity that they're not used to. So that's where them sparring partners really help bring that intensity up to help prepare for the big race.
Absolutely. And, you know, and no matter how, you know, these top guys, they get arm pumped too. You know, they're human also. You know, so if they're going up in a pressure situation or, you know, they have too much intensity off the start, they get tight and they can't move forward. You know, we've heard Tomac say that. We've heard a lot of the top guys say that. So, you know, don't get yourself down if something, you know, like that happens, especially for, you know, the listeners and riders that are out there. But very good point, Kyle. Heavy D, did you have anything to chime in?
Yeah. I just seen this today. I was floating around Twitter, and I said something back about it, but now that it hit me, I was wanting to ask you what you thought about it. So your man Steve Mathis had something to say about Deegan's sweeping performance at Minios, and I couldn't find the message again. I've still been looking at it, but he was like, yeah, go pro, top 10 outdoors, come back and win amateur national, and think it's like a supercross championship, something along the lines of that. What do you think of something like that, especially him saying it?
I'm not sure. I guess he's making fun of him coming back down to amateurs. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, like he's somewhere. Yeah, pretty much. I read some comments, and matter of fact, you know that burnout video you sent me?
Yeah.
He said something about that, and he was like, yeah, it's like, just kind of act like you've been there before. Ain't no need for all that. Like,
the way I look at it is we're just having a good time, you know?
I mean,
let us have a good time, you know? I mean, Hayden had an outstanding performance at Minios. Daxton is right there, ready at any moment, matching lap times, turning some faster lap times. Daxton has only been on bike for 6 days outdoor, mind you. He's been with Star for 5 weeks. They had been over on Supercross the entire time, got to ride Moto 6 days. And then, like I said, then it's time to go to war at Minios. And Daxton, I thought, stepped up, did a pretty good job. We wish for a better performance, but it's going to come for sure. And to tell you, you know, talking about arm pump, you know, both riders were dealing with bad arm pump. And just to tell you the kind of team Star Yamaha is, Bobby Reagan was ready to load up and go test, wanted to get the bikes right. He, you know, like, where are we going to go? They didn't know where to go, but he's like, well, figure it out. We're going to go somewhere. We're going to get these bikes right. We're going to get them right today.
Yep.
Anyway, so I mean, that's a lot to say about that team. They're going to get the job done. They're going to get it done now. But like I said, you know, at the end of the day, Star come out of there with every title in the pro class.
Mm-hmm.
And let Hayden do a burnout. We just have a good time. Dax was there. We was all enjoying the celebration. It was a good time.
Yeah.
So here's the exact quote. I found it. We're going to race pro, get a top 10. Drop down to amateurs, and yes, do a burnout when we win. Shake my head.
Well,
like I told Heavy D, I said it's part of the process right now. There's nothing for him to do at the moment, and he can't race Supercross until he gets his points. So there's nothing that he can do. So I mean, why not go and show up? But I think where Steve is coming from is he hates when riders blow up their bike after a championship. So I think that that's probably where it's coming from, because it's showing his emotion, right? I think if there wasn't a bike burnout, then I think that nothing would have been probably said, because he doesn't like, because there's been events in the past that somebody have done a burnout and like a rock come up and hit somebody in the face, or a piece of the tire or rubber or something like that, right? So I think that's kind of where he's coming from. But that doesn't matter. I mean, he's going out there and he's testing, you know, he's getting gate drops, like what me and Heavy D talk about. It's good to get these gate drops to test your motorcycle and to see really where you're at.
Oh, I agree. I mean, honestly, I get where you're coming from on that. And I mean, if that's his take, that's his take. But I mean, like, even if I would have been Dak and I won a Supercross championship, I'd have done it just for that one. But Deegan, he won every one of them in outdoors. I mean, I'd have done it too.
Oh, that 450 ride where he was damn near last and came all the way up. I mean, that was a impressive performance.
Absolutely, absolutely. As a matter of fact, after that, I went up to him and I just let him know how amazing of a ride he just had, because it was spectacular. Dax, as a matter of fact, to back that one up, both riders, they drew 38 and 40 gate pick, and so they were on the very outside. So both of them came from terrible positions, you know, and moved their way forward. And I think Daxton wound up got to fourth, and then, like I said, Hayden got to the lead. But the performance Hayden put on was spectacular. It really, really was.
Yeah, and he looked good doing it. I mean, it looked like he, you know, was the part. And Dax, too. I mean, Daxton, at least from what I saw, it seemed like Dax couldn't get his starts right in the Supercross, and he had to work his way up for a majority of it, other than that one title that he won, which was, was it 250 Pro Sport or was it 250A?
I think it was 250A.
Okay, yeah, and I think that was his best start that he had in the Supercross, but outdoors he had better starts, which helped him out a lot more. But like you said, they worked through the pack. They look like they're, you know, the part here in, you know, professional motocross, and they're on their way. And it's awesome to see Dax, a North Carolina kid, and now Hayden, a North Carolina kid. It's really, really cool to see. And after Hall, we were talking about him. I mean, Heavy D stated that was probably his first time on that Cobra electric bike, and he, you know, was able to come out with a second in each of his classes. So,
yeah, he was so upset. Not to knock Cobra at all, but you know, that bike I think is pretty new. But you know, he was just sitting there shaking his head, and he was like, you know what? He goes, I got outrun by a bike right here. I didn't get outrun by a rider. And I guess the bike, the KTM just pulls a little bit better climbing them hills right now.
Right.
They won't figure that out, but like I said, after, yeah, first time riding that bike, and he rode as hard as he could, but I think if he would have had a little bit more juice in that thing, he probably could have pulled out a championship.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And Kyle, it's honestly been awesome to talk to you. Do have one social media question from Tyler McSwain, which I have raced a long, long time. And it's cool. He wanted to ask you if you would like to be a professional mechanic for a rider one day, or is that a dream for you, or what's your outlook on being a professional mechanic?
It's just not for me. Whenever you can say professional mechanic, are you talking about for a professional rider?
Yeah, he's for a specific rider on a you know, a top team, like let's say, you know, Star Yamaha with like Ferrandis or somebody, right?
If the money was right, possibly. But I've been offered several jobs, turned them all down. Matter of fact, I have opportunity East Coast Supercross right now. I just don't know. I don't see it. If the money's right, I'd be all about it. But right now, my focus is building my business and working with the guys that I'm working with at the moment.
Absolutely, absolutely. And How can people get in contact to you, your social media, for any engine work? And I know that you you coach kids as well, correct?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So how can people get in contact with you? What's the best way?
Best way is just to reach out to me on my Instagram, Travis Racing Performance. That'd be the best way to get in touch with me.
Okay. Sounds good, Kyle. Well, we appreciate Kyle Travis, Dax Bennick, longtime mechanic ever since amateurs, and helps out with a lot of the local scene kids. And make sure you guys, if you guys need anything, make sure to hit up Kyle Travis. And Heavy D, did you have any other last questions for Kyle here? Heavy D said, okay, go ahead.
My bad. Sorry.
No, you're good. Sorry. I was just wondering if you had another question for Kyle before he ends the call here.
I was just gonna say, if y'all need any bikes, hit up Kyle, because he always has some killer deals on some, and he builds some badass ones as well.
Awesome, Kyle. We appreciate it, buddy. Thank you very much. We'll be in contact.
Yes, sir. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man. No problem. Have a good night.
You too.
All right. Bye bye. That was Kyle Travis here on the Imperative MX podcast. It was honestly awesome to hear from a mechanic in the industry that's been there just like you, Heavy D, and it's cool to see his outlook and his perspective on some of the topics that we talk about here.
Oh, 100%. Kyle's been around for a while. I mean, he's been with a lot of the top dudes. I mean, heck, he's been around a long time. Longer than I have, actually.
Right.
I mean, and like he's real knowledgeable on everything, and that's why, like, when we talk a pretty good bit during the week, you know, we always stay in touch, and he's always got the good outtakes on stuff. So, man, he's just all around awesome dude for sure.
That's awesome. And man, it's really cool to hear that Dax and Hayden and everybody down at the goat farm get along, and they're making it fun, but also, you know, they're being competitive at the same time. And that's, you know, the question that I had, you know, towards Kyle for that reason, I felt was good, because I think there's so much animosity, there's so much pressure, there's so much this, there's so much that within the sport, right? That I think these guys do need to get together. And speaking of Eli Tomac, right? Like, when he changed teams, he's happier. He's riding with other people when there was no way in hell he was doing that beforehand. And, you know, now he's able to go and chill there for a week at the goat farm and ride with these guys, and Hayden and Dax get to watch and get to see this stuff. It's honestly really, really cool. And I'm stoked for honestly both of them and Dax. I mean, local North Carolina kid. I mean, you can't not love him, right?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, I'm not 100% sure on, like, that whole deal. But I think it's crazy. Like, in our industry, they don't release a lot of information, like contracts, and they don't want people to know who they're talking to, which, I mean, I feel like if they did, it would pull in a lot more outsiders and spectators to the sport. But, like, I'm pretty sure he had an offer to go with them several years ago when he first went to Big Bikes, and he didn't do it, which is understandable. You know, that team is where it is for a reason. Bobby Reagan likes winners, and if you're going to go there, you better be ready to win.
Right.
So I think the timing was good now, but, man, it's like, you think about it. Like, he won that championship there, which is highly impressive, because from what I hear, he didn't ride that bike a lot. And me personally, riding a KTM and then going to a Yamaha is like a big jump. It's a huge jump. They're night and day bikes. So for him to actually go to Mineos, win a championship, and still keep it on the podium and run up front with Hayden, that says a lot, because, you know, Hayden's been on that bike for several years now. He's been on it grinding. They've been working with him. So him and that bike are one. So, I mean, like I say, that's highly impressive.
It just shows the talent.
Absolutely.
And that's what impresses me, is that he goes and signs with this team, and then automatically start Supercross. Like, not even much motocross, right? You just go ahead and just start Supercross.
Mm-hmm.
That's insane. And that's a lot of confidence that you got to have in a motorcycle, you know?
Oh, you got to have all the confidence in the world to do that.
Absolutely. But hey, if you're going to be on Bobby Reagan's Star Racing Yamaha team, I think your confidence level goes up a little bit in the bike. So I think you're going to be okay.
Oh, who wouldn't have confidence in that bike?
Yeah, no, it's honestly awesome. And we have Kyle Bitterman coming up next, the underdog. But before we do that, FXR, high-performance snow rider gear to motocross gear, FXR has you covered. The continuing growth of FXR means more selection for you. Jackets, jerseys, pants, gloves, and snow rider gear. Whatever it is, FXR has you covered, so make sure to go and check out FXRRacing.com. And speaking of FXR and professional athletes that wear the great gear nowadays, especially in sizing and venting, in my opinion, we have Kyle Bitterman, professional arena cross, on the line. Kyle, how you doing?
Hey, guys. I'm doing good. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man. Heavy D, you hear him okay?
Oh, yeah. Fantastic. Oh.
What's up, Heavy D?
What's going on, brother?
Hanging in there.
Yeah, the underdog. Kyle, actually, before we get started, FXR, how long have you been with FXR, Kyle?
I've been with FXR for, I'm going on 2 years now.
2 years. What's one of the best things about the gear that you enjoy the most?
Man, honestly, it's got to be the fit of that gear. It is unbelievable. Like the gloves, the pants, it's like just snug enough, it's stretchy enough, it's just amazing when you're riding it.
Absolutely.
And for being like a newer company, I mean, they've been around for a little bit now, but they've really been recently making a good push, and dude, the gear is unbelievable.
Absolutely. And the gear that you have been wearing in the professional arena cross season or series so far has been looking good. And hey, is Randy Richardson still giving you shit about the infamous title of the fastest man in Piedmont?
Oh yeah, he likes to go back and forth with me. It's a funny thing because he's I think he's only like a couple miles from me because I'm in Pelzer and he's in Piedmont. I'm literally the next town over.
Right. And that's
good.
Yeah, that's so funny. Randy Richardson from Michelin Bicycle Tires and Motorcycle Tires, giving the underdog a little bit of smack talk, huh?
Yeah. He's a character though, for sure. If you ever follow him on Instagram or something, it's something to see.
Oh, absolutely. He's a funny guy. And with arena cross, to get back on topic, it just started up, and we're now two rounds deep into this championship. And that first round, man, was a hard hit, no pun intended, but glad to see you rebound back and get onto the box for this second round this past weekend in Albany, New York. What's it been like for you so far with these first two?
Yeah, I guess we can kind of back up just a little bit before coming in from last year. We ended up second in the series. And then coming this year, like I kind of didn't plan on doing arena cross this year. I was like, you know what? Because I did a few supercrosses last year, and I was just getting some momentum, kind of getting my supercross feet back. And I was like, you know, I kind of want to make another push for supercross because arena cross has kind of been slacking in the pro payout and the overall points fund. Just the whole, it was kind of losing its, I don't know what you want to call it, but, you know, the limelight wasn't there like it used to be in the AMSOL days.
Right.
So, but Robbie and Jack, we got some new owners in that series, and they kind of came to me and kind of let me know their ideas and what they were willing to push for the riders, and really everything they were tailoring the series for was for the riders. So guys like me can make I wouldn't say a decent living, but make some money racing a dirt bike.
Right.
And, you know, they kind of persuaded me a little bit, and I was like, you know what? If it does take off, I might want to be there the first year to ride it out with them.
Right.
So that was cool. Fast forward, we were okay. So this year, arena cross, it started in November, right?
Right.
Usually, series starts up 1st of January. Well, this year we had two rounds in November, We had Albany, Georgia, and Albany, New York. And that first one, I was kind of coming in unprepared. Our 250 race bike wasn't done yet. And I was like, well, I have my 450 and I've been riding it, so let's give this a go. You know, let's just try to do the best we can do the first couple rounds. And I qualified decent. We had some big whoops, like the old Amsoil days, and right. I pretty decent. But then coming into the race, the first heat race, I kind of connected with somebody off the face of a jump, and I kind of wanted to go around them. And when I did that, we kind of connected, and it gave me like a whiskey throttle, and it just shot me left. And if you guys seen the video, you kind of see me flying up there.
Oh, you ate that shit like a champ.
I was in there. As soon as I took off the jump, I was in the air. I was like, this is not good. I'm going to feel this.
Yeah, and there's not much room, right? And there's nothing that you can do. And that's always, you know, probably the biggest fear, right, of racing these races, is that you don't have much time to mess up, especially on those tracks.
Yeah, and luckily, I kind of got lucky. It was the first lap, and there wasn't no other riders coming back around in that area. I think I was kind of, I guess I was trying to aim for the tough block, but I kind of went over them.
Yeah. Oh, no, dude, no, you sent it.
If you watch the video, you see the adjustment in the air.
Oh yeah. I was like,
oh, I need to get there. Like, I'm like, I'm watching. I'm just like, okay.
And I'm never one to bail out either. So I was like, all right, I'm riding this thing out. This is going to hurt. But I've watched it over and over. And if you see, like, I pretty much just let everything go when I hit. Like, if I would have tensed up my arms or leg, you know, I could have broke an ankle or broke a wrist. Pretty much I just let my hands blow off, took it to the chest. But the big part was I just took it straight to the groin. Mm. And you guys know the feeling. It wasn't
it's not good.
It wasn't too good. Yeah.
Dude, just the thought process of him just like, all right, this shit's gonna hurt. Let me adjust.
Oh, yeah. Well,
the first thing is that when I saw it, because at first, like, the camera that was actually recording the race, right? Like, you see it happen, and then they continue with the rest of the race. But as soon as I saw it, I was like, this is not going to be good, and there's no way that in the first round, this is what happens. I honestly couldn't believe it, and I was sitting there, man, and I was talking to my girlfriend. I was like, I cannot believe that this happened, and I really hope that he gets back up, and you were able to line up for that Consi. So that was good, and you are all the way on the outside, and I mean, we talk about that. We love to see the aggression and, you know, the confidence that you riders have. And you can tell off that start, you were like, I'm getting to that first turn first, because I'm not dealing with any of the chaos that's going to happen behind me.
Exactly.
Yeah.
No, it was definitely not ideal for the round one, but, you know, I was sitting there walking back through the pits, or I guess like penguin walking back to the pits. And I was like, man, I really have to muster up and get out there for the semi, because I can't. Because the way they're doing it this year is they're taking there's four heats, taking two riders out of each heat, and then we have two semis and then two LCQs. But now they're taking one out of each semi and one out of each LCQ. So, I mean, if you have a bad, you know, a mistake or get taken out in the first turn of LCQ or the semi, you might not make the main. Even though if you're fast enough, there's a chance you might not get in there.
Yeah.
So I was like, man, we definitely got to get in there to salvage some points here.
Absolutely, because you don't want to go, you don't want to lead the first round with a DNF and no points.
Exactly. But thankfully, I was able to walk out of there and regroup and didn't put the best results in, but I just, like, you know, we just got to do what we can do. And
it's salvaging what you can on a bad night, and that's what, you know, champions do. So
absolutely,
and that was honestly good to see you get back on the bike. I mean, I was clapping here in my home theater room that I have in the house, you know, and I was just excited to see you back, because I didn't want you to go out like that, because I would have been like, man, that's a really bad way to go out, especially in the first round, because I knew what happened, because as you know, I used to race Arenacross as well, and I just knew that because you could see that you were really close with that guy, and I said I knew exactly what happened. He bumped him, and he got whiskey throttle, and I couldn't believe it. But man, you have been around the sport for a long time, and one of the questions I have to ask you is the Evoy conversation for your middle name. I think you're probably the only guy that I have ever seen on a result sheet that every single time your middle name is there.
Yeah. I think, for a while there, it was because my middle name is actually William.
Oh.
Kyle William Bitterman. So Evoy is my mom's maiden name.
Gotcha.
My mom and dad never got married, but it took me for a while to get that dropped off. And then when I finally got it off, like legally off my name, the AMA thing, it always stuck in the AMA system. So every time I went racing, it was like, Kyle William Evoy Bitterman. I'm like, oh my God, what are we doing here? I go up there and I tell the ladies, I'm like, can we drop it? They're like, there's nothing we can do. It's in the system. I'm like, geez, guys, like, come on.
You know, honestly, it's just one of those local things that honestly, I don't think it really matters to anybody else, right? Because everybody knows who you are, especially around the local scene. But it's just always so funny that you know, all the way from Kyle, me and you have been racing for many years.
Yeah.
And,
oh yeah, way back.
Oh man, I mean, probably 80s and I don't think 60s. I think 80s probably.
No, because I moved to South Carolina right around 2007, and I was on 85.
Okay.
So probably around that time.
There you go. Where'd you move from?
I'm originally from Western New York.
Oh, okay. Okay. Did you? Yep. When did you actually get started actually riding? What age were you?
I started riding dirt bikes and racing pretty much right around 5 years old.
Okay.
I came from like a car racing family background. My dad raced bush cars. My uncle was in a wheelchair. He was racing dirt cars, and my grandpa raced asphalt cars. And I was supposed to be the next one in line to, you know, do the go-kart thing into the sprint cars and then, you know, into what could have been NASCAR. But I guess I had other plans as a young kid. I came home and somebody in the class had a dirt bike, and I wasn't old enough to race go-karts, and I was like, Dad, this kid's racing a dirt bike. I want to race a dirt bike. So we'd go by the Yamaha shop about every other week going to the car auctions, and I was like, we got to stop. And I get in there and sit on that PW50, and I fell in love there.
That's awesome. Yeah, no, and especially it's cool to hear because, you know, we've raced each other and talked a lot, but yeah, I never knew your background, and that's cool because I started at 7, but I never went the 50cc route. I went straight to 60s, so it was a little bit different from me. Local racing, I know that you do a lot of local racing, and especially, you know, you have a family and you have a job outside of work. It's probably really, really hard to balance everything and to be a professional athlete all at the same time.
Yeah, it's definitely tough and not easy by any means, but man, when you have a love for the sport, there's times where I'm like, man, why am I still doing this? Because I'm not making a living, like a crazy good living doing it. I spend a lot of my money. I do all my own workouts, mostly all my own mechanical work on my bike. I buy my bike. It's a lot, but it's just like that love of racing and competing. And that's kind of why I drift towards like the indoor stuff, because there's obviously a better payout. Your bike's not getting destroyed. You're kind of, you know, racing arena, you have more of that professional side of it. So I kind of gravitate towards that indoor stuff. And I love outdoor racing, but man, even like the local Top Gun Showdown races, when I'm there, I mean, you're going out for two practices, you're coming off, you're pressure washing bikes, trying to get the mud out of the radiator. Then they're calling you up for first moto. And then you get off that moto and you got like three races till the next one. I was like, holy moly, like, this is a job.
It's almost like a local national.
Yeah.
Oh,
then
man.
You get out there and you do pretty good and you make like 150, 200 bucks and you're like, huh.
Yeah.
That don't seem right. Why did I just do all this?
for that little amount of money. But it's all for the love of the sport, and that's what we all that's what we all do it for, and that's why we keep going. And it's honestly really cool to see that Arenacross is trying to come back in some way, shape, or form. I think it's going to take a really long time for them to figure out how to get back to the Amsoil Arenacross days. Right. But, you know, I love Arenacross. That's where a lot of my top accolades came from, and that's how I got my professional license and all that good stuff. And just traveling to those different arenas, getting out of the state, and for you with the fan interaction, and if you're, you know, the first heat race of the night, and right after all of the fireworks or the pyroglyphics and the rider introductions and all that, I completely understand why some of these guys, including yourself, want to do these Arenacross series and want them to, try to get you guys to have a decent living so that you guys can do this and still chase your dreams and, race your dirt bike at the same time.
Absolutely. You know, and we're thankful for those guys doing that. And it's bringing, like you're saying, that glory back to Arenacross. I mean, even right down to the opening ceremonies, like this year, we come out to we get to pick our song, you know, the spotlight's on us, we get to ride around, rev up the bikes, the fans, and, you know, growing up as a kid, that you dream of that, right? In Supercross, of course, but, you know, I'm probably past that point where I'll ever make it in Supercross like that, but it's still cool to be able to live out that part of that little bit of a dream that you had as a kid for the fans, to interact with those guys and to see kids cheering. Because most of the time, this is their first event that they ever gone to. You know, they don't know that you're not Eli Tomac or Ken Roxon. They just know that you're racing a dirt bike for a living and putting on a show, and they're just pumped to be there and just waving their checkered flag, screaming, yelling, and it's awesome.
Yeah, and it honestly gives me chills, you talking about it, because it reminds me of going back to Arenacross, and I love that stuff. And, I need you to get me in contact with somebody there, because I've tried to email and I've tried to text some people to try to get a media credential. So maybe you can throw in a good word for me so I can make it out to one of these, because I want to try and fly out to one of these and see the racing action, because I haven't been to an Arenacross in a couple of years. I think the last one I went to was the one they had in Greensboro a couple of years ago. But man, I definitely want to come back out, and I want to see see what they're doing, because you know, there may be some things, and, you know, some outsiders that may have, you know, some tips or some pointers, you know, especially for, you know, us, you know, from KP to yourself to Carlos to, you know, these guys that are still racing it. They come from, you know, the Arenacross series. And I feel like, you know, if they can get your guys' input on, you know, how things, you know, should go, and maybe not the same, right? Because you don't want to do the, you know, an old record all over again, right? But you want to bring that same intensity back and same professionalism back, and you know, business ventures and all that. Like, it was cool to be able to go to the MGM Grand for the amateur, you know, National Arenacross Championship. That was one of my favorite events that we did, like, three or four years in a row. And man, I got to meet so many cool people. And you know, Wes Kane, it's cool to see him back. It's good to see Grant Langston and Buddy Antonez in the booth. I mean, they're doing everything that they can, and I think it's going to take you know, a year or two, but I really hope for your sake, the rider's sake, and the industry's sake, and everything, that it continues this uptrend, because I think it's something that is needed for sure.
Absolutely. And the end of the day, it's just another form of dirt bike racing that we can watch, you know. No matter what it is, Supercross, Arenacross, Endurocross, Motocross, pretty much anything comes on the TV, I'm watching it. If it's two wheels, I'm usually hooked in watching it. Even like the World Supercross stuff, you'll see me checking lap times, watching the riders. I'm just addicted to it, man.
Yeah.
So any more form of racing, any more jobs we can give people in the industry, I'm all for it.
Absolutely, and that's what me and Heavy D were talking about with the World Supercross and with this Super Motocross, where you know, a lot of teams in the past didn't want to add more races, right? But now they're adding two more races, and other series are coming in. But realistically, as far as a fan goes to the sport, we should all be very happy, because there is more racing, guys are getting paid more, there's more series that are opening up, more sponsors that are coming in, and man, it seems like we're on a very good upward trend, and it's good to see.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think sometimes it almost kind of bums me out a little bit when you hear guys, when they talk about me, they're like, oh, that's the Arenacross guy. He's a Arenacross guy. I'm like, well, I'm not just an Arenacross guy. It's just kind of what I've gravitated towards to kind of make a living. I would love to do Supercross, but to do Supercross in the right way with the right, you know, equipment and the right training program, it just takes a crazy amount of money. And I'm not going to do it half-assed, and I know what you need to have. And so I just kind of gravitate towards Arenacross stuff. And at the end of the day, too, I can do pretty good at it, and you feel like you accomplished something versus going to Supercross. You get in the main event, you're running in the back. Nobody even knows you're there. The
right.
Camera never touches you. Nobody's interviewing you. Nobody cares that you're there.
Right, and you may get in the way and cause a lot of people to hate you on the social media.
Right. Yeah.
You know, something out of your control attack that can happen, you know, and,
yeah,
you know, you accidentally get in the way in some way, shape, or form. Heavy D, sorry, been keeping you kind of quiet over there. Do you have anything that you wanted to say here?
Oh, no, you good. Oh, man. Hey, y'all, it's all been said. I mean, another point, too, like Kyle said, he's not just a Arenacross guy. I mean, he's a local legend as well. Like, I mean, we put a bounty out on my guy several years ago at Cassie's Creek, and like, oh, dude, everybody like came out to woodworks just to like say, all right, we beat Kyle, but he, like, let me tell you how much of a savage my guy is. So when he was in sign up line, and I walk up to him, and we're sitting there chatting, and he was like, so how much is the bounty? And I think it was like $300 or $400. It wasn't nothing too crazy. But it was already like a pro purse payout. So whoever beat him, of course, got the purse and the extra like $300-$400. And he was like, so if I don't win, if they don't win, do I get it? If I win? I was like, yeah. He was like, okay, that may be a bit more motivation.
Yeah.
And my guy goes out there and just cleans up both motos. I'm thinking, all right, okay, I like it.
I was almost a little nervous. I'm like, man, I never seen this many pros here at Cassie Creek before.
Oh, dude, it was a full gate, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it was pretty close to being packed out. I was like, wow, I got my work cut out for me.
But did you have a little bit of pressure?
Yeah, I think there was a couple guys that, well, I think, honestly, I end up pulling both starts and kind of checking out. But there were some guys that kind of kept me honest and you know, being a tight, I think it was a night race as well, I believe.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, and when it gets a little dark there at Cassie's Creek, it has some shadows in the ruts, and you kind of got to know where to go. And I think I had a little advantage, you know, racing there several times.
Right. And, you know, what we always say, too, here on the Imperative MX podcast, talking to Kyle Bitterman here from AMA Arenacross, is that these local gate drops and these local tracks like Cathy's Creek and East Bend for myself, right? Like these night tracks, even, you know, Lake Sugar Tree, Birch Creek, any of the other ones. It's good to just get gate drops, right? Like, sure, you could be fit, right, outside of riding your dirt bike, but you also need to be race fit. And if you do not go and get these gate drops at, you know, even the local event, right, it doesn't matter if you're going and waxing your class or getting beat by local legends of these, you know, of these tracks, right? Like, at least you're getting these gate drops to make sure that your race pace is still there for whenever you go to bigger events.
Yeah, 100%. And I think you can see that trend in like the newer age motocross kids coming up through, where everybody's training at a training facility, you know, and everybody's just doing their motos, putting their grind in. And these kids are unbelievable on 85s nowadays. I mean, 65s, 85s. But I believe they lose a little bit of that competitive edge in going racing. When I grew up, I never went to training facilities or had a trainer or was at one location working on it. I went racing every week, and we went here, there, here, indoor stuff, outdoor stuff. You're racing different guys, so you learn that racecraft, how to read the race and how to let it come to you, how to chase somebody down, how to cut in, cut out. And I think these kids these days are missing a little bit of that because they're so focused on, you know, those four amateur nationals, and then we're just going to train the whole year. But when it comes to when you get thrown into a series, like say if an amateur guy wants to come to AMA Arenacross, then now he's got to learn a whole new racecraft. Because you can't be just a crazy amount faster than somebody. You can only go so fast in a 24-second lap time.
Yeah.
But you got to be consistent, smart, make smart moves on the first lap. And I think that local racing kind of helps that racecraft.
Yeah, and even picking your way through lap traffic, right? Because as we can see, that can be a big thing of it, like you said, reading the lines, reading the track, having your head on a swivel, because you need to know what's going on around you. And Arenacross helps, and going to these local races that people are like, oh, it's a night track, like why would I want to go and spend my night there where I can, you know, do gym workouts or something here at the house? Like, man, go and ride, man. Nobody's gonna, yep. You know, nobody's gonna be mad at you for going to go ride. Even if, you know, like myself, like I like to go to East Bend and ride because it's got good dirt and I like the track and all of that, right? But I don't know if you've ever been to East Bend. I want to say you probably have, huh, Kyle?
I have not. I have not been up there.
Okay.
I've seen videos and I've seen the people that go out there, and they always put on a good event and give out a lot of prizes for the amateur guys.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that I love about East Bend and Travis Rominger, who owns it. He does a lot for the kids, and that's what, you know, the sport needs. Yes, there's, you know, money that needs to be thrown out to the pros, but there would be no money thrown out to the pros if there was no local racing involved for these these kids to go and buy these dirt bikes to go and ride, right? So that the manufacturers can pay Ken Rocks and Eli Tomac, these guys that are on top. So but it's
yeah.
Go ahead.
No, you're good. But I think for us as like even like local pro races, I feel like there's just a disconnect somewhere in there that we are not hitting it for me, to go race at a local race that's not like a bigger Victory Sports race, an outdoor race, man, there's like you show up and there's like one other pro.
Right.
And you're like, you get five laps of racing and you're like, oh man, you barely make any money. You got only five laps on the track per moto, and you're like, man, that was kind of a waste of a day. Like, what the heck?
Yeah.
So I think there's just like that disconnect with local pro racing, and I feel like in this area that I feel like somebody can capitalize on to kind of bring some excitement back for us local pros.
Yeah, and that's
and what... I know like Jane Gammon and the Victory Sports, they do a great job for like the Top Gun Showdown, the Kawasaki State Championship race, and I know like Sugar Tree's been doing some stuff at Silver Valley, so we have some, but there's a lot of dead weekends that there's not stuff going on. I feel like somebody could definitely capitalize and have some killer local events for sure.
Yeah, absolutely, and hopefully with this podcast, yourself and Heavy D and multiple others that we'll have on, maybe this will kind of perk up the interest of trying to help out, and maybe even sponsors to get on board to try and get, you know, like a Silver Valley, the local national, right? Like it would have been cool to see you out there. We obviously know that, you know, you have other things that are going on, but a track like that where you have Justin Rodbell and Brandon Shar come up, and Freddie and Preston Kilroy and all these guys, I mean, I would think that amateurs would want to come out to a track like that before they go to Minios or, you know, even Loretta's or something like that, to make sure that they get that good rut practice. And it seems like a lot of people shy away from that, and they want to go to the not as rough and not as rutted tracks. And it's kind of unfortunate the way that it kind of goes. And so hopefully, you know, we can kind of perk that up a little bit here in the near future.
Absolutely. That place, they kind of look like a little mini narrow. Amateur national or pro national with all the ruts that were there.
Oh, I mean, Kyle, have you ever been to Silver Valley?
I have not. I was hoping to go this year, but my 450, I blew it up in the middle of the summer. I didn't have it ready.
Regardless of the fact, we'll make sure that you, in some way, shape, or form, get out to Silver Valley next year, because you will love that place. Big jumps, obviously, yeah. Right? And the ruts. I mean, it's survival of the fittest out there, Heavy D, huh?
Oh, bro, like it. It suits your style, like the flowy, like catching a groove.
I can't catch some big jumps too.
Yeah.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like super flow. Like my favorite track. Have you ever been to Pro Sport?
Yes, I have been there.
So that's my favorite track. I don't like that it's a whole. Yeah, and it also doesn't help that I have the record. up there for the longest jump and almost killed myself. But regardless of the fact, that's my favorite track. It's a home track for me, right? And I don't like the whole goat trail that it is. But for some reason, I just have a good flow on the track. Maybe it's just a hometown track feels, whatever the case may be. But Silver Valley has now become my favorite track. I haven't rode there since like 2017, I want to say. And when they did the local national for that $20,000 a couple of weeks ago, I went and rode myself. And at first, you're so almost timid because it's got a million ruts in every single corner. You don't know which one to pick, right? And then once you go out there for that second one, man, I started to find a flow, and it's got good jumps, so you have a lot of time to you know, breathe and kind of calm yourself down a little bit. It's got nice flow corners. Nothing's really too sharp. Everything, like the corners shape up really well. They don't get G-outs. Like at some of the tracks that we see, unfortunately, and not calling out any of the tracks, but it's just nice to have a good flow all the way around the track. And yes, it gets choppy and it gets rough, and that's what I love. I like having a challenge out there instead of it being flat and you almost having to go and kill yourself just to gain a second, second and a half.
That's pretty badass, and I'm definitely gonna try to get out there a couple times this summer before that race, and I hope to. Supposed to be up there for that race if they put that event on next year.
Oh, absolutely. Sure. And we plan on making it bigger and hopefully have a lot more top amateurs show up since it is A and B. And I feel like it's even good for A riders. Like me and Heavy D talked about, I never got put into the C class or the D class as soon as I went from 80s, because on 80s I was not very good, right? I didn't really pick up my speed until I was on 250s. And man, I honestly just enjoyed the fact of riding that track and finding the good flow. So definitely for next year, we definitely got to get you up there. Before we end up moving on from Kyle Bitterman here on the Imperative MX podcast episode number 7. Heavy D, do you have anything else for Kyle Bitterman?
Oh no, He's the man, and I can't wait to see him back out at the track some more. And definitely wish him all the best in Arenacross, because I'm definitely rooting for him every weekend.
That's what I like to hear. So I got one for you guys.
All right.
But what do you think about the old, because I know you're a Suzuki guy, what do you think about the old KR94 possibly on the Suzuki?
So, I have a TikTok channel, and I post stuff on there, and as soon as I got my Suzuki, obviously I'm going to get obliterated by every single person in the comment section. And it's so funny that literally I posted that Ken's possibly pretty much going to go to HEP Suzuki. And there's so many people that were talking shit on the Suzuki on my TikTok for when I got my Suzuki. And now it's so funny to go back and look at the same comments that they say now about Suzuki, and that they're so happy. It's like, an electric start, it doesn't matter, man. These bikes, all of these bikes are good. It doesn't matter if it's not updated since 2018. Every single bike from Alex Martin to Mumphy to Preston Kilroy, when I talked to him, he said, dude, the bikes are good. Like, they're fast. They're good. They have twisted doing their motor work, so you know that their engines are good. So, and I don't know why they get all of the hate. And now that Ken's going to go, realistically, everybody's going to love Suzuki, and he's going to win on it. And it's going to be unbelievable, because everybody was talking so much crap on Suzuki, and now, they have a top athlete, and Suzuki's going to come to the rise again. Heavy D, same thing?
Oh, yeah, I agree. I mean, I'm telling you, here's my theory on this. I feel like this upcoming season will be an all-time Supercross season. Ken stays healthy, I'm calling him for a championship, just because, like, man, he's in tune with that Suzuki, and with him back on it, Suzuki is going to revamp that bike. And when they do, I hope they keep the Kickstarter. I hope they do. Oh my god, I hope they keep the Kickstarter.
If they come out with a button, it might help them, but he can keep kicking and he'll keep winning, I guarantee it.
Oh, I mean, he's doing it for the I think I mean, I know that he talks that he wants to do the whole Super Motocross Championship, which is Supercross and outdoors, but I feel like it's going to be a WSX 2023 for Ken. I mean, why not go to 6 or 8 rounds, travel around the world, and you make a shit ton of money while doing it?
All right. That just seems like a no-brainer, especially you don't have to suffer during outdoors, you know?
Yeah, and it's even better. He gets to keep Red Bull. So Twisted T is not going to be on his bike. They're still going to be part of the program, but they're not going to be on Ken's bike. So, but Red Bull will be on there, Progressive, HEP, all that good stuff. But no, it's going to be interesting. What are your thoughts on it?
No, I think honestly, I think he does good when he's got something to prove. Just like coming back from that arm injury and then having the doubters saying that like he's not going to do as good on the Suzuki. I think just having that little extra motivation to prove people wrong, I think he's just going to come out swinging, and it's a great bike. I mean, he's going to have factory support, factory bonuses, and not saying that he's for sure on it, but it's leaning that way, and I think if he is on it, he's going to do great on it.
Yeah,
sure.
And me and Heavy D were talking last episode. It's going to be really good for him because he's been racing. Right, so he's been going to these different places and racing, riding different bikes, talking, you know, testing all of this stuff. So he's going to know exactly what he wants. And I already called him for Anaheim one. He's going to come out and win.
Yeah,
because he's just going to be on fire.
He was looking good on that red bike, though, man.
I know.
I can't change it right now. But he was looking good on that thing.
Yeah, because it was between Firepower Honda and HEP. So
not much longer.
But as you can see, as you can see, we won't keep you much longer, Kyle. Appreciate you coming on. But as you know, sometimes changing scenery helps. You know, Kyle, or with Eli and Jason Anderson. I mean, you saw it. You know, they had probably their best years ever this year, and with changing teams. So it actually might be really good for Ken.
Yeah, sometimes just changing your program with even the bike, you know. You might think you're struggling with a certain area on this bike and you ride something else and you think it's going to be way better and it's really not. But sometimes you might find something when you try something different, or, you know, you might be like, this is what this bike's doing better. And you try that. Like last year with us, the past 2 years, we've been on the gas 4-strokes and Arenacross. And honestly, we just could not get a good setup where I was comfortable turning, coming off the gate. It was like, man, we get it good in a certain area and then we lose it in this other place. And it was good outdoors, but once you put Supercross suspension on it, it felt way too rigid. And it was just like, you were just fighting it the whole time. And that's why we kind of made that switch back to Honda. And it's been feeling like, you almost feel like you're coming back home so much more comfortable.
Right. Right. Cause you know, the bike that's under you and you've known it for a long time. And I know you've rode Hondas, for a long time. So definitely having that comfortability underneath you definitely helps, especially in the mind. And I feel like that's kind of where Ken has been struggling with these past couple of years. And obviously it's understandable with all the injuries. So, no, I completely understand that. And Kyle, man, it's been great having you on here. And it's always a blast to talk to you, either on the gate at one of the local pro races or even coming on here. So, Kyle, appreciate it. Good luck in the upcoming rounds. Make some points, and hopefully you'll come out with a win. Oklahoma this weekend, correct?
No, we are off until January 6th.
Okay, so I thought Oklahoma, yeah. I thought it was 3 in a row, but okay, so you guys are off until January.
Yeah. We have a little downtime, so we're going to be kind of regrouping, getting our race bike tested, tuned up, and then the truck and everything's going to be heading out west. But I just wanted to, if you don't mind, I'm going to get a shout-out to some people that are supporting.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I just want to say a big thanks to the Lasting Impression race team. All those guys there, Jason, Ashley, Telsky, Corey, just everybody that's behind those guys. Can't thank them enough. Even their whole families, because they all got to deal with us being gone the weekend. And then my boss, Troy Chris, he's the one that I work for during the week, so he kind of lets me take these weekends off and certain days off to go practice and test. And then he also does my suspension, so it kind of works out hand in hand there. So big thanks to that guy right there. He's a big, big part of the program. And then FXR, of course, you guys know about those guys. They're keeping me looking good and reading across. been enjoying it, and just all the sponsors supporting our team. I can't thank everybody enough.
That's awesome, Kyle. It seems like you guys got a good program over there, and we look forward to seeing you back up on the box and up top here soon. And good luck in the future. And man, we'll be talking, I'm sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Y'all hit me up whenever. I enjoyed it, and y'all enjoy the show.
All right, partner. Appreciate it.
See you guys
later.
See you.
That was Kyle Evoy Bitterman here on the Imperative MX podcast, and man, it was good to hear from Kyle. Honestly, his knowledge, and he is so cool. From kids and even me, right? He always smoked me, right? But it doesn't matter. I mean, we always talk on the gate, and when he was the first professional I brought up about the Imperative MX podcast or having a podcast for Imperative MX. When I saw him in Atlanta. When he was doing Supercross this year, and I brought it up to him, and I said, "I want you to be the first professional, racer that I bring on to the podcast." So it was really cool for Kyle to come through on that, and he talked to us for about 45 minutes. So that was really cool to see from a top professional AMA Supercross racer and local legend of himself down there in South Carolina. Heavy D.
Oh, absolutely, man! Kyle's a killer dude. Works hard, loves the sport. And like you said, extremely knowledgeable about it. He's been around for a while and definitely somebody awesome to look up to, especially in the moto industry.
Absolutely. And we have to thank Dirt Industries Custom Graphics. Heavy D, tell me a little bit about Dirt Industries Custom Graphics.
Man, so you got Neil and Miss Ashley over there at Dirt Industries. They do an awesome job. Local to Rayford, right over there at Dreamville MX, where it is the North Ship Wash Memorial Race this weekend, matter of fact. But they do awesome work. They do custom graphics, vehicle wraps, even vehicle trailer wraps, and jersey IDs, and much more, man. So y'all definitely check them out. Their ID kits are insane. Love the jersey ID kits. Custom graphics. Neil is he's the master over there on the keyboard when it comes to doing some designing, and they got some fresh new chrome material in. It's one of a kind. I don't think any other companies have it. So if you guys haven't checked it out, you most definitely should. So check out Dirt Industries over there. Hit them up on social media, DI Wraps and Dirt Industries Graphics, and go look them up. And I'm telling you, you won't be disappointed with them. Some of the best customer service there is.
Absolutely, and for over 10 years, they have designed, manufactured, and marketed the highest quality dirt bike graphics and decals to the motocross and consumer markets. Their high quality deals are considered by many to be the best in the industry. If you would like to get your graphics looking top notch, go no further than Dirt Industries Custom Graphics. Heavy D, you said for the social media, but for their website, Dirt Industries graphics.com, and you can save 10% by using the promo code the code Imperative MX, no space, and all uppercase. And we also have to give a huge thank you to Hydropower for being on board as well. Hydropower is formulated by sports nutritionist Garrett himself to help you get rid of arm pump and increase your endurance so you could ride safer and faster, like myself and Heavy D say. I want to say every single time here on the Imperative MX podcast, we always want everybody to be safe and ride faster while doing that. So if you want to do that, make sure to go and check out drinkhydropower.com to get your Blue Raz today. Man, that stuff is good. I got it right here, right next to me while I'm on the podcast here to keep me going. And man, this stuff tastes very, very good. And man, are you going to Dreamville this weekend, Heavy D?
I wish I could, but I don't think it's looking too likely for me. I would love to get out there, man. I tell you, the newborn and the younger, it's going to be a little rough, but I'd love to be out there.
I'll be out there for Imperative MX. I'm going to make the 4-hour trip and go down to Dreamville MX down there. It seems like it's going to be a fun time. And moving right along from the ad reads here with Dirt Industries Custom Graphics and Hydropower, can't thank them enough for being on the podcast. But man, local racing schedule updates and events. We have the Noah Shipwash Memorial Race at Dreamville this weekend. Make sure you guys come out to that. I'm going to be there. Zach Heron's going to be there. It's going to be awesome. It is round three, I believe, of the Southern or the Winter Series. Heavy D, correct me if I'm wrong. Yeah. I think it's the third. Yeah. I think it's the third round.
Yeah. No, I think it's the second round.
Okay, or second round. I'm sorry about that.
I could be wrong, but I want to say it's the
it,
round,
it is part of the NCMX Winter Series. So,
correct.
So make sure for you guys, if you are around the area, to go and check out. Also, Rayford is only right around the corner. Dirt Industries Custom Graphics. So. And I know Ashley will be there. So, supporting Dirt Industries and Noah Shipwash and, also Dreamville MX. So, man, it's going to be awesome. I know Birch Creek is racing this weekend for those, that can't make it out to, Dreamville, this weekend. So Birch Creek will have a race. I don't know of any other races, Heavy D, that's happening this weekend. Do you?
No, I don't think I do. Other than that, I mean, I think this one's a Lone Ranger this weekend, so it should be a barn burner, that's for sure.
Absolutely. So there's a big pro purse, $3,000 for the Noah Shipwash Memorial Race at Dreamville this weekend. 65 cc's, top five. Every single racer gets a 6D helmet. So that is going to be super cool for, I think it's 65, 7 to 11, if I'm not mistaken. But regardless of the fact, go and check out NCMX on Facebook, Instagram. You'll get all of the details that you need there for the weekend. And if any track promoters or track owners that would like to get their track or event mentioned here on the Imperative MX podcast for a weekend, email imperativemx@gmail.com so we can get your track or event recognized. Anything else racing, local racing, wise, Heavy D, that you wanted to get into? Anything? Does anything in general?
Shoot, I'm trying to think. Other than that, I think that's it.
Yeah, because I didn't have anything else as far as topics for local racing other than just the events that's going on and the racers that race down in Minios. I will say, going back into the Minios talk for just a second, it's cool to see, like I said in the very beginning of the podcast, that these riders that don't do well at Loretta's come up and show out at Minios, I guess I should say, towards the end of the year to move them into the following year, 2023. Carson Wood, Liam Olaf, Noah Stevens, Christian Janik, Julian Balmer. I mean, all of these kids, they showed that they can win in their respective classes. And I think moving into the future, there's going to be a lot of, I think there's like five guys in each class that I watched in Minios that had a shot at winning at some point. And I think the competition level is rising, and it's really, really good to see.
Oh, absolutely. You know, it's funny that you bring that up, because like you got the kids that go to, some of them that go to Loretta's and they don't do good, but then they go to Minios and they show out. Like I remember several years back, who was it? Jared Fry. You remember Jared Fry?
Yep. Hey, yeah, what's going on with him now?
It's funny speaking. I honestly don't know.
I know, man. He's been so quiet on social media, but regardless, go ahead.
His brother is a mechanic for Star Steel.
Yeah, because he went to the Firepower Honda team, and then because he was on Star, then he got dropped from Star, ended up going to Firepower Honda for 1 year. Was it this year in Supercross? And then we didn't see him in outdoors at all. I mean, he was struggling to make main events, Heavy D.
He was more of an outdoorsy guy than, like, if they would have gave him more time, but that's the only thing, man. They, I understand you're a team. You got to win. It's business.
Yeah.
You know that it is what it is. I mean,
it sucks.
I, at the end of the day, that it sucks. That's why they're successful. But I just feel like, I mean, they should give these kids more time. And also, it goes back to the fact, just like the whole trainer, he lived the MTF basically his whole time he rode.
Right.
He stayed there. And, I mean, he was fast. Don't get me wrong.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, Jared was hella fast. Still right. Hella fast. I don't know why I'm speaking like it's past tense, but it's just one of those deals. Like, a bunch of those kids, they go there and they don't race. I just take it back. They didn't race enough. And, like, when you get to that level, you don't have time to, like Kyle was talking about, in a sense, you don't have that time to start trying to learn a racecraft. Like you said, you can only go so fast in like a supercross or a supercross track or an arena cross track. But then that's where, like, your racing instincts start to come into play. And a lot of fast dudes don't have that racing instinct. Like, they just don't. Like, they can go out there and go fast as hell in practice, and they can race and they can do good, but they don't know how to go win.
Right.
It's hard. I think it is. And that's a problem. Like, that's why I feel like a lot of guys should go race more. Like we was talking about Shane, like that year he got his TLD, dude, he raced so much. He learned how to go win, even though he didn't win Loretta's. I mean, he had Cooper. I mean,
right. And that
ended up winning that year, but he was still there. It wasn't like he was trying, like, but he just got edged out just a little bit. But he learned to race.
Yeah.
And I think that helped him out a lot. And some guys, like even the pros, like, you know, they, a lot of them that won in amateurs, they get to the pros and they fell off because they get out of rhythm of that. They sit there, they test, they train. Like, I mean, you could train all you want. You just get
burnt out.
Exactly. You do. Yeah. I mean, you do.
Because of the grind. Because I think maybe a lot of these kids won't get burnt out if they just go and race instead of putting so much. I understand the training, and trust me, I get it, and the diet and all of this other stuff. But, man, let them go race. Let them go have fun for the day, right? Because they all say that the racing day is the easiest part. So why not let them go, you know, let them go race, get them out of these pillows that, you know, they're stuffed into, and let them go and, you know, race some of these local races or, you know, whatever. You know, we almost probably beat it over the head way too many times, but it's true. I mean, you heard it straight from Kyle Bitterman. All he had no trainer. He never went to one place and stayed. All he did was race. And if you go to a local track and you have never seen Kyle Bitterman ride, you would think that he was Eli Tomac.
Uh-huh.
Because he's just that fast at a local level. And it's crazy to see that there are people that are faster than Kyle even out there. Because at a local level, I mean, he's ridiculous. So,
oh, man. Yes. You see a lot of them like that. Like, I mean, not trying to go back to it, but the Silver Valley, look at how fast Rob Bill was going. It's hard. It's like, okay. It's mind-boggling. Like, him, Preston Kilroy, like, Brandon Scherr. It's like, how can you go any faster than they're going?
Absolutely. And speaking on Silver Valley MX Park, the local national, man, just a good place. Deep, rough, big jumps like we talked about, and so glad that they are supporting us here on the Imperative MX podcast, episode number 7. Answering some social media questions. Before we get into that, Heavy D, What is one of your favorite tracks that you actually rode? I don't think I ever asked you that. What was your favorite track that you rode?
Camp Coker.
Yeah, I only rode that place one time.
That my hands down. I rode it one time. I raced. That was my first race ever, and I mean that's my favorite. Yeah, I'd say that's my favorite one that I rode for sure. Just because, like, that was my, not only it was my first one, but it made me, like, well, okay, let me go ahead and say this. I wrecked every corner and every wheel and every roller there.
Right.
I probably made a total of that whole weekend I went there of 10 laps. That was Saturday practice and racing Sunday, just because it was that gnarly. But it like showed me how like gnarly the sport of motocross really is, and it showed how bad I really wanted to ride and get better, because seeing like the dudes race that, like that track, I'll never forget. Like, it was so many people there. Like, you had the Curry brothers, you had Steven Hauser, Kyle Peters, Billy Wink at the time, McSwain, Cooper, it was so many, dude. And watching them, I was like, all right, like, these dudes are gnarly. Watching them ride sand, it was insane. Matter of fact, I'll never forget that weekend, Tyler McSwain rode for Rockstar Suzuki at the time on 85s.
Yep.
And Cooper pulled every hole shot, and McSwain would come back and beat him every moto, like, the last lap. He was just ripping that weekend on 80s. And I was like, I seen that, and I was like, dude, I want to be fast like those kids. I never got there, but I was like, I want to be fast like those kids. Like, they're fucking on it. Excuse my French.
Yeah, well, trust me, Heavy D, from the previous episodes, I think episode number one or two, I mean, as soon as you saw the sight of B-Class, you said, I'm out.
Oh, yeah. I knew. Like,
said, I'm out.
It's like, you see it at the time, and, like, you see kids ripping on 85s, but, like, over the years, like, you've been there. Like, the level has just gotten higher and higher and higher over the years, and it's, to me, it's absurd how fast dudes are going right now. It don't make sense to me.
It's, in the 22 years that I've been in the sport, it has almost flipped upside down with how fast kids are. Like, don't get me wrong, there's always been fast kids, right? But it seems like it is an absurd amount nowadays.
Oh,
I mean, everywhere you look, there's a fast kid popping up. They're like those annoying, they're like those weeds that you pull every year, you know, at the beginning of the year, so you can make the, you know, the driveway or whatever the case may be, your garden, whatever, make it look good. And then they just pop right back up just a couple of weeks later, and you're like, I thought we were done. I thought we were done. But no, there's just more that just pop out of nowhere.
Matter of fact, to go back, I'm not trying to backtrack, but speaking on the racing topic, race so much, Abster Hall is a prime example. All he does is race local.
Yep.
But you see how fast that kid is.
Yep, and because you ride all the time, you know that instinct of everything with the motorcycle. You're in tune with the bike. You know what gate drop feeling is like. You lose some of that nervousness, that butterfly feeling, so that you know that you can get a good start and run up there at the front. And yeah, I mean, Kyle Bitterman, Kyle Peters, Luke Neese, Justin Rodbell, all of these dudes are prime examples of what we talk about with, you do not have to go to a training facility to be, you know, super, super fast on a dirt bike.
100%.
We had a question on Instagram from Wade Stew. He says, he asks, do you or Heavy D think that the Warrior class for veterans like myself will ever be recognized as a Loretta Lynn's class in the future? So, do you think that the Warrior class, or do you think there'll ever be a Warrior class for veterans at Loretta's for a race, Heavy D?
You know what? I'm going to give it honest. Should there be? I say yes, 100%. And God, this is going to sound bad. I don't want to sound like a dick saying this. Excuse my French. Asshole.
Excuse my French again.
Yeah, excuse my French again. Man, I don't want to say it, but I try to be honest, and I want to be honest. It should be, yeah, but I'm going to say no, because it doesn't benefit MX Sports pockets.
The only thing that I could think of is that Vet MX and some of these other companies that are for the veterans are popping up and helping with the veterans, and obviously they have Warrior classes at these tracks, but at the top of the amateur national sport, it's going to be really hard, but also at the same time, I would think that they would maybe consider it just for the fact that there are a lot of veterans that do ride and probably are in some of those plus classes already, racing. And it's just another – it would be really cool for, let's say, Wade, right, like that doesn't ride very much, but he can still go to a local amateur national. Doesn't matter if he finishes 36 or finishes first, but he gets to experience lining up at Loretta's, where maybe in the C class or in the plus 30 class, he won't be able to make it because the competition's so high. But maybe in the Warrior class, because there's not top professionals that are in the class or guys that are, you know, super, super fast because they've been riding their entire life, it gives them an opportunity. I want to say yes and yes, because I believe that yes, they need to have it, and yes, they need to have a class at Loretta's. Now, if it is it going to happen, I don't know, but
no, I agree 100% what you're saying. I think it should be, but I don't think it will, because and there's nothing wrong with it. I feel like those, because you know, when I was at Dreamville and Rayford, Fort Bragg is right there. We had so many guys from the service start getting dirt bikes and coming out, because for them, it's a relief. They can come ride, they can free their mind, because dude, they go through so much when they're out and battle or doing
whatever,
like all the other stuff it is for us to be like have our freedom over here,
right?
But at the end, you know, like we would give them discounts and like Betamax, they race for free. I feel like 100% it should be like that, and they should have a class at Loretta's. They need one, like, to show more appreciation, because they do so much for America and our country. But that's why I say, in my honest opinion, I don't think it will happen, because it's not benefiting on the money side for MX. They ain't getting anything out of it, which sounds so harsh and so shitty,
right?
And I'm not trying to sound shitty, excuse my French again, because it costs so much to go there and race.
Yeah,
and everybody's paying that same fee, and I think on MX Sports part, I don't know, I can't speak for them, this is just me on the outside looking in, it would look shitty for them to charge them. So why not, like, okay, they can get their fix just doing the local thing, and I think it's probably good enough for them there. It shouldn't be like that. I would love to see it, but I mean, they possibly could on down the road. Like, yeah. Hell, next year they probably could they could listen to this and put a Vet MX class at Loretta's, just to make me eat my words if they would listen to this podcast.
Yeah,
they heard this.
Yeah, that'd be funny. Like, we're running the show here. But what you say is right, because you almost don't want to charge them right when they come through the gate, because you're like, man, you know, if it wasn't for you, right, I wouldn't be able to be doing what we're doing here and racing and stuff. But I think even Wade, I'm sure that, you know, he's a good friend of mine, I guarantee that he would still be willing to pay the money to still go and ride at Loretta's and do all the, you know, pay for parking and, you know, all of that good stuff. Should they? No. But to ride their dirt bike and to line up at Loretta's and to say that they race Loretta's, get a bib, you know, and potentially get some, you know, podium speeches or whatever the case may be that they've never done before, man, I'd eat the bullet and do it and see what happens. I mean,
I would. Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, you're only doing good. Nobody's ever going to tell you that you're a bad person for having a Vet, you know, MX class for, you know, the biggest amateur national race. And, you know, even if you give them 10% off or 25% off their entry fee or maybe 50% off their entry fee for their class and make them pay full price for their parking, regardless of the fact, you can still make a little bit of money with them, right? Like, as far as a business goes, but maybe it doesn't need to be, you know, myself if I were to show up to go and race, you know. But I feel like it would be really good for, like, some of these companies, like FXR or something, right? Like, if FXR had a rider that won or got on the podium, right, like, they could have an ad for, you know, a Veterans Day or for 4th of July or something like that, with, you know, their, you know, that vet rider on the podium, FXR gear. I think sponsors would be with it for marketing reasons, and I think that they could still make a little bit of money. But I think that they would have to work through it on how it would work. But Wade, yes and yes. Is it going to happen? We don't know. Pretty much. And it's kind of almost unfortunate, Heavy D.
Oh, no, it is. I agree.
And it's super tragic. But that's the only questions that we got for this podcast. Episode number 7 of the Imperative MX podcast. And what a phenomenal episode that we had tonight. Minio's chat with Daxton Bennick. Or Dax Bennick, practice bike mechanic for years. It was really cool to hear his story and hear all of the knowledge that he has coming from the goat farm there with Dax Bennick and Hayden Deegan. It was really 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 cool to see you know, that side and to hear it from a mechanic that's still there on the day to day grind. Kyle Travis there. We also chatted with Kyle Bitterman. A lot of local racing talk that we had with him, along with his professional Arenacross you know, championship chase that he's going after right now after 2 rounds. So it was really cool to hear from Kyle Bitterman himself. The underdog, Evoy Bitterman. I still think that that's so funny, but it was cool to hear the background on that because, you know, like I said, I've known him for a very long time and I've never heard that story before, so it was really cool to hear. We talked about local racing, the schedule, and much more into this jam-packed episode number 7 of the Imperative MX podcast, huh, Heavy D? It was a pretty good one.
Oh yeah, it was solid, man. I always look forward to it every week. I can't wait to get on some topics, and we have some awesome guests as well.
Absolutely, and this is just the beginning on some of the guests that we'll have and more here on the Imperative MX podcast. But before we sign off, we have to give a big thank you to all of the companies who make this possible each and every week. West Virginia Motorsports and Princeton, West Virginia. If you need anything for your dirt bike, ATV, side-by-side, you need a new dirt bike, ATV, side-by-side, or anything in that nature, make sure to find your key to fun at West Virginia Motorsports. FXR, Kyle Bitterman, killing the game with the lit kit. A lot of lit kit awards to give out from the weekend or from the week at Minio's. A lot of kids and a lot of racers were wearing FXR, so make sure to check out FXR social media, FXRRacing.com. Dirt Industries Custom Graphics, Heavy D.
Hey, Dirt Industries. Go get the best in the game.
Go and get the best graphics in the game. Dirt Industries Custom Graphics. Find them on social media and dirtindustriesgraphics.com. Survey Valley MX Park, the local national, Heavy D. I don't think we need to speak any more on the local national at Silver Valley.
Oh, no. Hey, it speaks for itself.
That's right. And last but not least, Hydropower. You want to get rid of some of that arm pump and get a little bit more endurance out of yourself. Don't get as fatigue throughout the race or your motos, practicing, gym, work, here on the Imperative MX podcast sitting right next to me. So make sure to go and check out Hydropower. And Heavy D, that pretty much wraps it up. So thank you to you people for listening on this week's episode. Make sure to check us out on YouTube, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook. Also, find the Imperative MX podcast on Apple, Spotify, and much, much more. For myself, Zach Newberry, and co-host Heavy D, we're out. We'll see y'all next week.
See you guys.